This is not just water. For some, it means long-held goals will be fulfilled. While others may face crushing failures. But one thing is for certain. This is all we dream of.
It's go time in Japan. Sailing's World Cup Series is back. The 2019 season kicks off in Enoshima, the Olympic sailing venue of Tokyo 2020. A star-studded field of Olympic medalists, newly crowned world champions, and young guns is ready to hit the waters of Sagami Bay.
Enoshima, sailing's host city for the Tokyo 2020 Olympics. So a crucial opportunity for the 450 sailors from 45 nations to test themselves on the Olympic waters. I'm Alec Wilkinson and this is round one of a brand new World Cup series. World Sailing's World Cup Series is an annual circuit of Olympic class competitions. With the world's top sailors competing in 10 Olympic disciplines at 4 epic sailing destinations around the globe, the competition is intense. The racing mirrors the format of the Olympic Games, making it the best preparation for athletes on the Olympic pathway. Competitors race against current world champions, multiple Olympic medalists, and new emerging talent. The 2019 series will be the hottest to date, following closely after the Hempel World Sailing Championships in Aarhus 2018, where 40% of Olympic places were decided. The road to Tokyo is well underway, and sailors are now vying for national selection to the Olympic Games and a piece of World Cup glory along the way. The series opens on the 2020 Olympic waters of Enoshima, Japan. Next, we return to a series favourite, Miami, USA, before heading to Europe. First to Genoa, Italy, and then on to the highly anticipated World Cup Series final in Marseille, France. The 2019 series is here. The sailors are in it to win it. Who will be crowned sailing's World Cup champion? First up, the men's laser, where it's a close battle for silver and bronze, but gold is won already by a dominant Elliot Hansen of Great Britain.
You know, the laser fleet is so tight, and I think on a different week, you can get three different medalists, it's that tight. So it really is not too much pecking order, and it's about doing it on the week that really matters.
It's been a long road to recovery from ankle surgery for Hansen, but his form here has been remarkable. Sitting second overall is Tom Saunders.
Like you said, it's been a bit of a struggle for everyone, apart from Elliot, who's sort of jumped out a bit. But yeah, it's been tricky, just trying to minimise your losses and try and take the opportunities when you can has been the biggest thing.
It'll be tough for Saunders, with Olympic and world medalists right behind him. Fly into Sagama Bay and have a look at the race course being used for the medal races. It's an up and down course with a downwind finish, and for some classes there'll be a dogleg to the left or right for a reaching finish. Sail number 212789, the one to look out for, that's our gold medalist. But what a battle between Saunders of New Zealand, Wern of Australia and Bull in fourth, as the clock finally ticks down and we are off with the laser medal race. Great start from Jean-Baptiste Bernard from France, as he leads the fleet out to the left-hand side of the course. Tacking out and heading to the right side is our overall leader, Elliot Hansen, and Sam Meach of New Zealand goes with him. Wern of Australia, closest to the camera, coming off the pin end and clearly showing that he favours the left side. Ball and Saunders battling it out in the middle of the course. Conditions getting lighter as the leaders approach the top of the course, tacking to find the best breeze. Bull there keeping himself in the hunt for the medals, along with Saunders of New Zealand. And at the top mark, it's Tom Saunders who leads. Stepanovic of Croatia second. Philip Bull of Germany rounds just behind Bernards of France in fourth. The fleet approaching the gate marks, but the data from the water is telling us there's a big bias on the right-hand mark. Bernards on the far side, rounding the more advantageous mark, but Saunders and Bull, neck and neck, choose the opposite mark, and this could prove costly for them. Stepanovic rounds next, with Michael Beckett right behind. The majority of the fleet choosing the far mark. Bull and Saunders still to get around this mark closest to the picture. And it's going to be a decision that costs Bull and Saunders dear as they slip out of the medal positions. We're with the leaders as they approach the top mark. Wern in the red bib looking to take full advantage of the poor decision by Bull and Saunders. Bernards out in front and around the top mark in first place, followed by Matt Wern of Australia. This position will see him with silver if he can hold on to the finish. A great upwind leg by Mickey Beckett and Sam Meach as they battle for bronze. And there's the gold bib of Elliot Hansen, also in the mix. As the boats make their way downwind for the final time, Bernards continues to lead, with Wern, Beckett and Meach all vying for silver and bronze right behind him. Bernards calm and collected, looking to win this medal race as the wind drops and suddenly things get more tricky. Bull and Saunders doing everything they can to recover, but there's not a lot of racing left to do. Jean-Baptiste Bernards wins. A little punch from him. He's out of the medals, of course. That was always going to be too much of an ask going into this with the points he had. But some satisfaction in tricky conditions, and he has won the race. And second goes to Wern, and that seals him the silver medal. Wern happy with that. Gold was always unachievable for him, of course. So a great result for Wern. But there he is, the gold medalist, Elliot Hansen. He celebrates, he punches the air. Gold was always secure going into that race. But confirmation that Wern takes the silver, and a great sail from Sam Meach sees him take bronze. Heartache for Beckett, though, who came so close, but also for Bull and Saunders, who lost out on their chance for a medal.
It's amazing to win on the Olympic waters. There's a real history of those that are able to perform on the Olympic waters in the previous years before the Games go on to have great success. So that's a great confidence boost going into the next 2 years.
So running in third position, opportunity to gain a silver medal, but also the opportunity to lose out of the medals completely with such points being so close. So yeah, it was a nice tight race.
The young Briton celebrates as he continues his campaign to qualify for the Olympics. Next, it's the windsurfers.
Two Olympic gold medals, two world championship titles, and countless other top results, all embodied in one person. Dorian van Rysselberghe from the Netherlands is the highest of high achievers. The newly crowned world champion is one of the most decorated athletes in the RSX windsurfer. Van Rieselberg has set his focus on nothing short of the three-peat, another gold medal at the Olympic Games in Tokyo 2020.
You know, I grew up on an island in the north of Holland. My dad used to windsurf and my brother windsurfs. And yeah, we went to the beach every summer, every day. And yeah, after a while, you know, you're scooping your little bucket and putting sand in there, but you see your dad and your brother windsurfing, you're just like, I want to do that too. Come on. When I was around 18 years old, I saw that, you know, the Olympic class was changing, the RSX came up, and I was like, oh, this is an interesting class for me. I've always had an Olympic dream from when I was like 13 years old. I said I want to win an Olympic medal in London. And yeah, I rolled into the Olympic class and trained hard and kept having fun. I said we got what you need, honey. If I do my best and I get the maximum performance out of my body, I should be able to win an Olympic medal here in Enoshima, hopefully gold. But you know, we're not there yet. I have a lot of hurdles to jump through and challenges to fulfill.
Dorian Van Rieselberg, one of the biggest personalities in the boat park. It's Van Rieselberg's teammate that sits top of the standings, but all the top four are challenging for gold or silver. It's a gloomy, wet start for the RSX men's medal race, with second place Camboni of Italy in the middle of the fleet there. On board with the overall leader, Kieran Badlow. He's had a good start, and the world silver medalist is challenging near the front of the fleet now. Very little in it between the leader and the chasing pack. Coming to the first mark, and Mengfang Gao of China has the perfect line on this left-hand side. The Chinese windsurfers, both men and women, always strong in the RSX. Previously very successful on Japanese waters, and Gao already has a good lead here. Now look at third here, because the battle for bronze is hotting up, with Camboni falling back, but Sants sitting in third. Badlow sitting second, but that's easily good enough for gold, because Camboni has dropped to eighth. A good race from Matteo Sants of Switzerland, the lightest man in the fleet, and looking good for bronze. Gao's held on to that big lead on this upwind leg, and you've got to think now that the race is his. Down he goes on the final leg to the finish line, and Badlow only now reaching the mark. Sants in third. Gao wins the race, but was always out of medal contentions, and Kieran Badlow of the Netherlands will finish second and claim the gold in Enoshima. That's how it finished, and Sants ended the race fourth, but it's enough for a silver medal, and Pierre Lecoq of France takes the bronze. In the end, Italy's Camboni had to settle for a fourth place. But the man with the gold round his neck is Kieran Badlow.
It's really important to do well here, because obviously we got the Olympics here in 2020, and everybody comes here and wants to see what they can do in the Olympic venue. So yeah, it's real important to do well in this one and to see what you can do, and I'm just happy that we got off to a good start. It's the first major event here, and yeah, I'm happy to come out on top.
Last year we had the same dates, the World Championship here, and I also finished second. And for me, that's really important, because it's showing that I feel good here at this venue.
Enoshima Yacht Club, a venue steeped in sailing history. The host venue for the 1964 Olympic Regatta, this iconic site will once again host the sailing events of the Olympic Games in 2020. This year's event is a highly anticipated road test for the elite of Olympic sailing.
Japan's yacht club was very ローカル的な話普及がなかったからですからオリンピックがなければ今日じゃないですよ。東京オリン前回のオリンピックはですねヒールボートが多かった。今回みたいにディギーでもやるセンターボードのスピードのボードじゃなくてやるフィンクラスだけは前回と今回残ってるけど、いや前回のフライングダッチマンとかスターとかドラゴンとか 5.5 もう全て変わっちゃってね、階級は変わりません。まあやっと東京で、まあ、2度目のねオリンピックが決まったと。やはり日本でオリンピックやる場合は江ノ島が一番日本一の海でありレース海域であるから、もうウェルカムで非常に喜んでます。
Getting a taster of what it'll be like to sail in Enoshima for the Olympics are the 49er FX.
It's a high performance fast boat, double trapping. It's a skiff designed by Bethwaite, and hull weight is 94 kgs. It's the same hull and everything as a 49er, but the FX has a smaller rig. Designed for a smaller body weight of two females.
One hull boat with wings and got three sails, a main and a jib and then a kite. And you're two persons on the boat hanging off trapezes, wires, to make it go fast.
Boat handling is really critical. It requires a lot of fitness, a high fitness level.
You have to find a good partner. There's synergy of two persons, that's the thing that makes the boat go fast. You have to have lots of hours in the boat. You cannot just rock in from the side and think you can make it go fast. It's a lot of hours behind, but everybody can learn it, I'm sure.
The team to beat, as is often the case, are the Olympic champions of Martina Grail and Kahina Kuntsa, and they have already sealed gold going into the medal race. But what a battle there is for silver and bronze, with four boats separated by just 5 points and the top eight all in contention for medals.
I think the most important thing for us was like to sail well and try to minimize our mistakes and try to read the wind.
Brazilians' second big international regatta since Martina Grail took time out to compete in the Volvo Ocean Race, but they've won gold. Who can take silver?
To be honest, the points are so close in going into this medal race that it's just going to be like any other race, and we just need to try and do our best.
Well, the Brits well placed for that silver medal. They go into the race in second place, but can they hold on? Great starts in this medal race for the 49er FXs, with the Norwegians close to the pin end and the Brazilians in the centre of the line, and second place Britons Dobson and Tidy just to windward of the Brazilians. Lighter winds here on board the Grail Kuntsa boat as we watch them move their weight in and out to adjust to those changing conditions, keeping their eyes out for breeze. The Brazilians edge to the front of the fleet as Dobson and Tidy of Great Britain tack out and make their way to the right-hand side. Maloney and Meach, after a poor start, are way over on the right side of the course, and they're looking good. Roble and Shea from the USA and our overall leaders coming back into the middle of the course there. Dobson and Tidy of Great Britain lead with the fleet tightly bunched behind, going straight into a jibe set there. And Americans Roble and Shea are going to round that top mark in second. Then come the Norwegians. And the Dutch have come into the mix as well. Now Beckering and Dootz, the world champions. A clear split in the fleet, with teams choosing both the right and the left sides of the course here. But only one side can pay. The Norwegians, Nace and Ronningen, lead at the bottom gate. But look at this gain from Maloney and Meach, the Kiwis, as they move up to second, which would be enough for silver if they can hold on. Dobson and Tidy with the white spinnaker were leading at the start of this leg, but they've lost out on that far side and they'll be feeling the pressure now. Brazilians around in second as the Norwegians are heading for home in front of them. Maloney and Meech coming in third. Bryant and Wilmot of Australia on their heels. Norway take victory in the medal race, but look how tight this is. Sweden, Australia, Brazil. Here come the Kiwis at speed as well. Will they take second right on the line? Yes, they do. Pipping Wester and Netzler of Sweden on the line. And the Brazilians with a late charge there as well. So goal to the Brazilians, but what a performance from Maloney and Meech to take silver. And from Wester and Netzler, the Swedes, who get bronze. Unfortunately, the Norwegians, Nathan Runninger, picked up a measurement penalty that cost them the race win and sees them finish in sixth.
We only had a little few days break between after the Worlds. And I think that showed up to be our strength here, because we were one of the earliest here to arrive in the race course, and we were super adapt to the weather and to the time zone, and you know, I think it made a bit of difference to being very confident.
So the whole FX fleet, besides the Brazilians, were really close on point, so there was a lot to play for, and it was kind of just about having the best race we could sail, and that's what we did, so we were happy with that.
After two races on day one in moderate to strong winds, sailing superstar Giles Scott came out on top. Day two featured a strong performance by Jorge Zarif of Brazil. Again, in a tricky but solid offshore breeze, he closed in on Scott. On day three, Zarif managed to temporarily pass Scott in the overall ranking, but the Briton fought back in race six with a second place finish when the wind started to get lighter, again showing his strength as a consistent all-round performer. But an even more flawless performance was displayed by Dutchman Nicholas Heiner, who'd picked up a points penalty on day one, but kept sailing super consistently, continuously moving up the leaderboard. After six races, he ranked second. All Finn racing was cancelled on day four due to no wind and rain, but the fleet managed to compete twice in light and challenging winds on Saturday. Heiner continued his trend up the leaderboard, topping it before the Sunday medal race. On Sunday, the sun came back, but the wind remained marginally light. The race officer tried everything he could to get the race away, but didn't manage to start it before the cut-off point. So positions remained the same, with Great Britain getting silver and bronze through Giles Scott and Ed Wright, Jorge Zarif of Brazil just missing out, but gold went to Nicholas Heiner.
Yeah, so I think this has been a great week to test Olympic waters and to come away with a medal on the Olympic waters for 2020 here in Japan. I think it's a great motivation boost and gives a lot of confidence going into the Games.
The sailing race can be divided into four distinct phases. The first is the pre-start phase, which lasts from about 3 minutes to 30 seconds before the start. During the pre-start, teams are trying to anticipate the favorite side of the start line and the race course. It's a phase in which sailors try to weigh risks and rewards with their minds constantly working in overdrive. The second phase is the actual start, which is the most crucial part of a sailing race. All teams are trying to cross the start line with maximum speed when the start countdown hits zero. So in this phase, sailors need to be super alert to judge time and distance with pinpoint precision. They are also trying to create a little gap to leeward, which helps to gain speed and height after the start. In the third phase, the post-start phase, teams are aiming to capitalize on a good start or maybe to make up lost ground after a bad one. Everybody is looking for slightly cleaner wind and the next opportunity on the race course, such as areas with less waves, stronger breeze, or favorable wind shifts. The post-start phase lasts roughly until halfway up the first beat. Once boats have settled in their position after the post-start, the remainder of the race is all about catching up and defending by sailing smarter until boats eventually cross the finish line. Traditionally, this phase could run for hours, but a modern Olympic medal race only lasts for 20 to 25 minutes. So when we talk about a sailing race and analyze what happened, we usually go through these four phases: pre-start, start, post-start, and catch up and defend. And like in any other sport, when someone ends up winning, there's an additional wave the flag phase, except that in sailing, it also involves a jump and a swim.
From the other Olympic classes. I really love it because it's so fast in a strong wind. In light wind and medium, we use a dagger board, but when it's strong wind, we use just a fin and we really fly. You have to be really strong and really smart. And for sure, you should know your equipment. You should test it. You should try to understand what equipment is good for you. Our new design is so bright, so it's even more beautiful, and if you see something bright, for sure it's R6.
Lining up for the RSX Women's Medal Race, Olympic and World Champions, a really exciting fleet, and only 3 points separating first from second. But it was so close that all the top eight could also win a medal. Sitting top right now is Rio silver medalist Paina Chen. Silver medalist in Rio and the woman to catch here in Enoshima. The Chinese sailors always perform well here.
It's been a long journey coming back after having my baby. So being close to the podium, this regatta is really exciting.
35 years old, but still a tough challenger. Bryony Shaw will definitely have her eye on that gold medal. All the sailors bunched close to the committee end of the start line. That's because there is a bias at that end. Oh, poor starts from Bryony Shaw of Great Britain and Paina Chen of China, both tacking out towards the right-hand side now. Lillian de Geus of the Netherlands leading the fleet as she crosses in front of Paina Chen, along with Hongmei Shi. Yunzhu Lu leads at the top mark. She's squeezed in front of De Geus and Chen. But where's Bryony Shaw? There she is with the blue bib in the background, dropping down the fleet and seeing her medal chances diminish. At the gate, and the top three have a gap over the rest of the fleet, with Lu still leading teammate Paina Chen and Lillian de Geus from the Netherlands as well. Lu looking really good, and she's moved up now into a bronze medal position. The breeze is increasing as Katie Spychikov charges downwind, trying to close the gap on de Geus, who's jibed off early and is still some distance in front, you can see. At full speed across the line and with a commanding lead, Yunzhu Lu claims the bronze, a superb achievement given she started in sixth. Here's the woman of the moment, China's Paina Chen, taking second in the race, but gold overall. Lillian de Geus takes a well-deserved third place finish, which secures her the silver medal. So China's Paina Chen takes gold in Enoshima, De Geus takes the silver, and what a performance from China's Lu, who claims the bronze.
The race is quite tough because the wind has shifted and the wind go up, down, and then, but I try to do my best what I can do, and I think I'm doing quite well.
It was really close points with the rest of the girls, and I just tried to seal my own race and do my best and try to be the first in the top three of the medal race.
The 470 women's fleet proved to be a battle amongst equals, with the overall leaderboard constantly changing throughout the week. But standing out because of their consistency was yet another high-achieving team from the Netherlands, Aphrodite Kiranaku and Annelouche van Veen, who stayed in the overall top three all week. Their closest rivals were the locals, Aikondo Yoshida and Miho Yoshioka, who started out as fifth overall after day one, temporarily climbing up to first place on day two, only to drop back down to seventh after two difficult light wind races on the third day of racing. Day three also saw a very strong performance by the Italian team Di Salle and Dubini, who scored a fifth and second place, putting them in the lead before the rain and lack of wind prevented the 470 women's fleet from finishing a race on day four. Race seven on Saturday proved to be the deciding match, with Yoshida and Yoshioka coming second and Kiranaku and van Veen scoring a third, which was good enough to put them back in the lead. The Italian pair Di Salle and Dubini dropped down to third overall after crossing the finish line only in 10th place. Race 8 only cemented the podium, with the leading three boats finishing within the top five. Unfortunately, when it came to the Sunday medal race, the lack of wind meant the 470 women could not race. The final leaderboard reflected an outstanding performance and well-deserved victory by Kiranaku and van Veen. And the local heroes and world champions in the end got the silver medal, and Di Salle and Dubini of Italy took the bronze.
We are very happy to be able to race on Olympic waters and also have a good week like that. It's too bad we didn't get the chance to have a medal race and a good fight with the Japanese and the Italian team, but it was really nice to win again.
Foiling on an Acra 17 is just like flying, only better. The two-person hydrofoiler is the fastest and most spectacular class in Olympic sailing. Sailing on the wing-like foils favours the speed freaks, such as Ruggero Tita and Caterina Banti. This Italian duo have been flying high in the rankings ever since the foils were added to the NACRA last year.
Foiling is like an art. We are enjoying it every day, learning new things. Every day, every single minute we sail.
We started sailing together with Ruggero since 1 year and a half almost. And we started with one goal, go to Tokyo and get a medal in Tokyo.
It's the most important thing. The two person of the crew, the two body has to move like one, have the same feeling on the boat, and try to feel the same things what the boat is asking. We are enjoying our sailing day by day and try to find new things to let us improve every day something. And that's maybe the key. We really like the boat and we enjoy it sailing.
And that enjoyment has translated into becoming world champions last month. But will they win gold here? They're certainly in the right position, sitting proud on top of the leaderboard, but being chased by the Australians and their teammates in third. Jason Waterhouse, Lisa Darmanin off at the pin end, alongside the Italians Bissar and Frascari. But a clean start for the fleet. On board with Waterhouse and Darmanin as they head out towards the left side of the course. Good acceleration away from the fleet as they prepare to tack and cover the fleet back into the middle of the course. Coming up to the top mark, the Outridges have the chance to squeeze inside their fellow countrymen, Waterhouse and Darmanin. Nathan Outridge takes his boat round that top mark in the lead. Jenica hoisted. And the gold bibs of the current overall leaders, Tita and Banti, rounding in third. An increasing breeze as these boats take to the foils and blast downwind. Waterhouse and Darmanin going into a jibe to hold on to that inside line on the outrages. Oh, look how tight it is approaching the gate. Upwind for the second time. It's Australia first and second. Can the Italians, Tita and Banti, hold on to gold? At the top mark for the final time, Waterhouse and Darmanin lead. The outrages jibe early, looking to create the chance to overtake into the final few hundred metres. Bissar and Frasca have made a gain on the near side. Jason Waterhouse crosses the line to win the medal race and take gold. Bissar and Frasca takes second, securing bronze by just a few metres from the Australians, the outrages. But where are Tita and Banti? Here they are, flying in to take fourth, but it's not good enough. They'll see the gold slip from their hands and they'll have to settle for silver. It also ends their winning streak in 2018 that culminated in a world title. So it's silver and bronze for Italy and gold to Australia. The outrages finished fourth.
Yeah, it was an awesome medal race. We had to get a few boats between us and the Italians to win it, but we also had, you know, our fellow countrymen, Nathan Outridge and Haley behind us, and also the other Italians. So it was a real race at the top of the fleet.
It was a really tight points situation and everything can happen, and we know that. We still said a good medal race, but it was not enough to get the gold.
The 470 men's class traditionally features a very strong Japanese squad, and here in Enoshima they were keen to show to the world what they could achieve on their home waters. Keiji Okada and Junpei Hokazono took the lead after race two and held on to it right to the end of the regatta. Only the Australian 470 legends and double Olympic medalist Matt Belcher and Will Ryan managed to crack the Japanese domination through their consistent performances. The Aussies came away with the silver. The podium was completed by Daichi Takayama and Kimihiko Imamura, winning bronze. With just under 2 years to go to the Games, the Japanese have shown they are a force to be reckoned with, finishing with three boats in the top four, including gold and bronze. That is real strength in depth. Once their home Olympics are underway, Japan will hope, no expect, their 470 crew to deliver. Time now for one of the fastest boats in the Olympics.
The 49er is a double-handed skiff class. It is sailed with two people with three different sails, a spinnaker, a jib, and a mainsail. The boat is a skiff, so it has a very flat bottom, and it planes both upwind and downwind in certain conditions. It's very tippy, and it's a blast to sail around the race course.
You need to have the control of the boats, like it's a part of your body, that you know all the small details, that you feel how the boat reacts in a certain situation.
So all the sheets are always in each person's hand at all times. So the skipper actually trims the jib upwind and drives, and the crew trims the mainsail and does all the controls. On the downwind, the skipper takes over on the main sheet, the jib sheet's cleated off, and the crew hoists the spinnaker and trims the spin sheets downwind.
Well, the uniqueness of this boat is, I think, the instability of the boat. So to get the boat in balance, it requires a perfect a harmony between the skipper, the crew, and the boat itself.
The flatter the boat is, the faster it's going to go. I mean, it's an amazing feeling. It feels like you're gliding across the water. It feels like you're basically floating on air. So both the helm and the crew both trapeze. And so that feeling of kind of flying over the water is definitely an awesome feeling to have. And it's definitely something I think most people in the class really enjoy.
Except this is going to be such a close medal race. Equal on points at the top between Peters and Sterrett of Great Britain and Purbacek and Kolarzynski of Poland.
You know, it's starting to feel more and more like the Olympics as we're getting closer. But I suppose we're a little bit later in the year still, so we're expecting maybe slightly different conditions in late July, early August when the Olympics will be.
James Peters very experienced in this boat, and with it so close and conditions as they are, he's going to need to call on all that experience tactically to stay ahead of the Poles.
Really happy that we could come to Enoshima to see the Olympic venue, just to try how winds goes and how the water works in the water. And we are really happy with the regatta and the trainings here.
The Poles have had an inconsistent 2018, but here in Enoshima they have hit form and have put in some really good performances. Kiwis are quick off the line. Logan Dunningbeck and Oscar Gunn. Great start from them. Peters and Sterrett side by side with the Austrians. Bilstein and Hussel in the middle of the fleet. Coming away on starboard, closer to the committee boat. This is all about speed now. And holding a clean line, ready to take the first wind shift. Overall leaders wearing the leaders' yellow bibs. That's how the fleet looks now, with three of the major medal contenders positioned at the top of the picture on the right-hand side of the course. Peters and Sterrett with the inside line and the lead at the first mark. Now in the background you can see the Poles coming in, and they started equal on points, remember, with the Brits. So the Poles have dropped down. We're on board with the Britons, and it's all going according to plan as they lead their rivals downwind. Now look, the Poles and the Kiwis battling it out near the back of the fleet, and that could open up an opportunity for the French team, Fry and Delpech. Peters and Sterrett jibing for the near side gate mark, still comfortably in the lead as the rest of the fleet converge in on those downwind marks. The wind softening now as the Britons head downwind for the final time, but they've got a considerable advantage. Job's nearly done for Peters and Sterrett. They're heading towards the finish line, just out of shot on the right-hand side of the picture. But behind them in second are Fry and Delpech of France, and that is significant. It could be enough for them to take bronze. We'll have to see. But Peters and Sterrett are almost at the finish line, so they take the gold medal. Now, where will the Poles and the Kiwis be? Because that will depend on whether this French boat gets bronze. Gold for the Britons. Job well done. Confirmation of the medals. The Poles did just enough to take bronze, so the French down in fourth. But it was a good silver medal for the Kiwis.
Yeah, it's been a good week. We're happy with the result. Second's good, but there's a lot to work on, and didn't have the best medal race, and yeah, spent a lot of time punching around the back.
You know, we've been in that position before, and we know we can turn on when it matters, and so it was just kind of make a good start and do the basics well, really, and then see how the race unfolded from there. It kind of felt like everything was going our way, which made it a bit easier.
We've got some fresh, new, young talent doing some things that I know you haven't heard before.
One, two, three, listen.
Sarah Douglas from Canada, a young gun in the mix in the Laser Radial. Sarah just participated in her first ever medal race at this year's Sailing World Championships in Aarhus, Denmark. Finishing sixth overall gave her a taste of the spotlight, and that now fuels her desire to work her way up to the Games in Tokyo 2020.
Sailing's just a sport that I absolutely love. I love being on the water, and the freedom that you get from it is just something that you can't experience anywhere else. Yeah, I've been sailing for a really long time. I did my first Opti World Championships at only age 10. And from there, I was really, really into youth sailing and youth racing. And I think I maybe got a little bit too into it and kind of lost the love of the sport. And I took a little two-year break back when I was just only 17, 18. And I started coaching Optis. I ended up being inspired by some Olympians. There was a gold medalist from Canada, and she had her London gold medal around her neck, and I just kind of had an epiphany saying, what am I doing? I love this sport and I want to have an Olympic medal. And from there, I started training full time, and now here I am 4 or 5 years later. My goal is Olympic gold. That's what I want, and that's what I'm striving for every day.
And Sarah Douglas goes into the medal race in sixth place. But out on top is Marit Bouwmeester. She's got an unassailable lead. The gold medal is hers, but it's so close for the remaining medals, with the top seven all in the hunt for a medal. The fleet spread out right across the start line. Nearest to us, world champion Emma Plasgaard, and she looks to be in some trouble. She's having to do a penalty turn. So obviously picked up some sort of infringement as the rest of the fleet head off across the start line. Now this plays into the hands of Hannah Snellgrove of Great Britain, who was only 3 points behind the Belgian at the start of this race. But Plasgaard will now have to refocus and try and get back into the race. Here's Bouwmeester, no pressure on her, she's the leader. She has an unassailable lead. The gold is already in her pocket. Conditions very light and even spread across the course, which highlights just how tricky and variable the wind is. Olsen on port approaching the centre of the course. She's looking in a strong position as she nears the top mark. Van der Vaart of the Netherlands and Snellgrove closest to us. Plenty of work to do for them. Josephine Olsen has sailed an excellent first leg. Olsen in control at the top mark, out in front, as Young of Great Britain and Jonker of the Netherlands come in on port for second and third. Bouwmeester right behind them. Now conditions beginning to look ever lighter as the rest of the fleet round the top mark. Oh, look at that. They have slowed almost to a snail's pace. These light conditions means concentration absolutely vital. You can see our Olympic champion here with gold already in the bag, having to really concentrate and balance her movement. Bouwmeester on the right, Olsen around the left mark now as the sound signal that tells us there's a change of course, so there's been a wind shift. Plasgaard and Snellgrove side by side in the middle of the fleet as Bouwmeester extends her lead. What a great week it's been for Bouwmeester. She's been absolutely dominant in this fleet. Such a lead now between her and the rest of the fleet. Olsen well placed for silver, and Plasgaard now moving up the ranks to hold on to bronze. And there are a lot of boats between Snellgrove and Plasgaard, potentially too many for the Briton to make up and get a medal. Well, look at her go. 3 world titles, 2 Olympic medals to her name, and she took silver last month in Aarhus at the World Championships, and she is absolutely absolutely dominating this Laser Radial fleet. An amazing set of results that this week have qualified her to represent the Netherlands at Tokyo 2020. Snelgrove looking for that inside line on Plaskaart, but she's running out of racetrack if she wants bronze. Big smile and a punch of the air. Every victory means so much for Marit Bouwmeester, our gold medalist, who also wins the medal race. Josephine Olsen crosses the finish line. Silver is hers. A wave to her coach. Emma Plaskaart crosses in fourth to take the bronze medal. Sarah Douglas of Canada in fifth. And so Emma Plaskaart took the bronze from Hannah Snelgrove, who finished fourth, but it was gold for Marit Bouwmeester.
It was nice to get my spot secured for the Olympics, so I don't have to see all the events next year and can come here to prepare myself a bit better. And it's been a challenging week, and to win the medal race as well, it was actually a nice ending of a good week sailing.
Of course it's important to get a medal on in the Olympic waters, because the Olympics are here and it's always nice to perform here on these waters, so I'm just stoked about that.
6 days of racing on the Olympic racetrack, so lessons learned as well as medals won. For the sailors, this has been a vital learning ground just 2 years from when the Games come to Enoshima. Happiest of all will be the Dutch team, who leave Japan with four of the event's 10 gold medals. The World Cup Series now moves on to the USA in early 2019. The city of Miami will once again play host in January, when all 10 classes return to action in the Florida sunshine. Until then, from me, Alec Wilkinson, it's goodbye.